M.C. to shining sea.
And what I'd like to do right now is to bring on our first performer. This guy is a comedian, an impressionist, a great, wonderful entertainer, and you will see him in the second week in November on the Craig Ferguson Show. I want you to make him really feel comfortable here tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Scott Record. Come on, let's hear it for Scott.
Hello! Hello!
Hello! All right, that's good. All right, now let's do it formally. Good evening. Well, hi, this is Casey Kasem with a one-of-a-kind opportunity just for you. A four-record set, the top 40 of the 1960s, featuring early classic voices like Bobby Vinton.
Lonely, I'm Mr. Lonely.
And, of course, Dean Martin.
I lie, had it in my power. Girl to have your child.
And old Satchmo Louis Armstrong.
Hello, Dolly, this is Louis. Dolly, it's so nice to have you back where you belong.
And the king of rock and roll, Elvis Presley.
Wise men say, thank you very much, son. Only fools rush in.
But wait, there's more. From the non-lyric category of the 1960s, some of the most memorable mumblings ever from great groups like the Rivingtons. And the Marcells. And some old lyrics from old Blue Eyes himself. And great groups like David Clayton Thomas with Blood, Sweat, and Tears.
For what goes up must come down. Spinning wheel, got to go round.
And the godfather of soul, James Brown.
Wait, I feel good, yeah. Woo, knew that I would give it to you. Feel bad, self.
And the brothers from Australia, the Bee Gees.
Smile, an everlasting smile. A smile can bring you near to me.
And the mood barometer of the 60s, Bob Dylan.
Once upon a time I felt so fine. Gonna find a sign to kind of find it. Didn't you?
And the number one recognizable voice from Woodstock, Mr. Joe Cocker.
What would you do if I sang out of tune? Would you stand up and walk out on me every night?
The top 40 of the 1960s. But if you buy now, we'll give to you free a collection of some of the most obscure hits of the 60s, ones you can't find, like this one from Bobby Goldsboro.
And honey, I've missed you, and I'm being good.
And who can forget from Japan, Kyu Sakamoto with Sukiyaki.
Omahatasu, haru no hi, hito ni bochi no yoru.
And another obscure hit from Bobby Goldsboro.
See the funny little clown, see him laughing as you walk by.
And the singing nun. And the king of the obscure hits of the 1960s. Bobby Goldsboro. The one song I'm glad you can't find watching Scotty grow.
B-R-L-F-Q spells mom and dad, but that ain't too bad. That's my boy. Now wait a minute.
You know you make me wanna shout. Put my hands up and shout. Put my head back and shout. Get my feet out and shout. Let me hear you say you will. Let me hear you say you will.
Now, this is Dr. Fail from the Oprah Show. And we have issues here, people. We have issues right here in this room. Some of you people are idiots. And you know who you are. So let's get real. We have financial issues, marital issues, memory issues. Memory issues. We have many, many issues. We even have impression issues. We have issues pertaining to impressions of Jack Nicholson.
But we don't have any issues with this impression of Jack Nicholson.
How the hell are you, New Yorkers, man? Jesus, it's great to be here. I love New York City, NYFC. Every time I go there, I stay at the Waldorf, catch a Lakers game at Madison Square goddamn Garden. You know, I stayed at the Waldorf. I'm checking in. There's a priest checking in front of me. He looks at the clerk and says, "I want to be assured that the porn channel here is disabled." And the clerk says, "No, it's just regular porn."
Good evening. I'm Scott Record. How are you tonight? Oh, what a show you've got. What a show you have here with such a wonderful orchestra and so many talented people. And as I said, my name is Scott Record. I've been here a few times before. Record. I used to tell a joke in my act a long time ago because Record's my family name, R-E-C-O-R-D. I used to say, well, it's a good name for my family because my dad just turned 78, I'm 45, and my wife is 33 and a third. Oh, a little bit of a reaction. I only do that now to see what people remember what a record was. They don't exist anymore. We live in a digital age, you know? I have a shelf in my house, and my daughter's 16-year-old Hannah, she's here, she goes, "Dad, what is that?" I said, "Those are my Frank Sinatra albums. Every song Frank Sinatra ever recorded." He said, "You never listen to them. Everything's downloads, iPods, MP3s. I go, "Frank Sinatra's recording of New York, New York, to this day is still one of the most played records in jukeboxes around the world." Now, there's only 5 jukeboxes left. Around the world with records in them. And they're all warped and scratched and skipped and in terrible shape, and they just keep playing them. So here's Frank Sinatra singing New York, New York, as it would sound in one of those jukeboxes.
I drew the very heart.
in a heap. It's up to whip. Oh, New York.
Let's
thank you very much. Good night, everybody.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the very talented Mr. Steve Solomon.
Sal Richards, ladies and gentlemen. So I'm from Sheepshead Bay. Get out of here. And when people say, how do you know? I say, well, let me tell you my phone number. My phone number was Nightingale 88220. For those of you under 50, those of you with children under 50, we used names back then. Well, do you remember Neptune Lanes? That was Nightingale 88229. So every day I would get calls for Neptune Lanes. I would have a ball on the phone with my characters and voices. I get a call ahead. Listen, I want to reserve a lane. I'm sorry, a lane's not available. I can get you Margaret or Sue. They didn't call back. And my dad goes crazy. He says to me, so he's from Russia.
So what do I do when they call and they want to sell me something?
I say, hang up on them, Pop, or have fun. I have fun on the phones. When one of those telephone solicitors calls me, I use a voice, a character, a dialect, something you can get even with them. The other day the phone rang, I swear it was one of those 800 numbers, so I pick up the phone.
Hello?
Oh, hi, is your mommy home?
Who is it?
It's John from State Farm Insurance.
Who is it?
John from State Farm Insurance, is your mother home?
You yelled at me. My mommy's not home, but my daddy's upstairs with the lady plumber. Something about his pipes. Oh, John, you know what?
What?
I saw my brother's tiny little pee-pee.
Oh, it's adorable. How old is he?
26.
The schmuck didn't call back. One lady kept calling and calling. I picked up the phone. I went like this. Hi, listen. We're having some trouble with our phone lines. Would you mind give us MSR? She says, I'll call you right back. Herkley, I. She calls back. I pick up the phone. That's the voice I like to use to get even with the girls at the drive-in windows at Burger King, McDonald's, in the back. You can never understand what they say. You pull up, you hear,
somebody else say, go I say back away.
What?
How's your office in your bus?
Some hamburgers, some fries, and a Coke. Two minutes later, the manager's out there going, testing, 1, 2, 3. Can you hear me, Quonisha? It's Quoshima! One lady called a half a dozen times. I picked up the phone and went like this. Hello, thank you for calling the school for the deaf. I'm sorry there's no one here to answer your call right now. But if you leave your name on the tape, it won't matter. We can't hear shit. So I flew in. I was in Rome 2 days ago, so my jet lag is, you can't believe it. But the things that happened, they're still doing things in Europe that they didn't do here, like ask you questions before you get on the plane. And the questions are amazing. I'm looking at the guy, he says, did anybody give you any packages to bring on the plane without your knowledge? How would I know?
Did anybody you do not know help you pack your bags?
So I assumed a character, you know, I said,
come to think of it, last night I was in my hotel room minding my own business, there was a knock on the door. I opened the door, there's a guy standing there with a turban. He had a long beard. He was carrying a rifle and he smelled like a camel. And he said to me,
you do not know me. I'm here to help you pack your bag.
I almost missed my flight. So I'm on a 757. There's three seats and three seats. Look at the size of Steve. I didn't have room to fart. I'm in the middle. The lady next to me was nauseous for 4 hours. Have you ever been sitting next to somebody who's sitting there going? I said, will you just throw up already? The guy behind me was watching the movie Eating Peanuts. Epis, one of the peanuts must have gotten stuck in the back of his throat. Because all I'm hearing is... What are you doing back there? Choking or reading Hebrew? We had a snorer on the plane. Not a snorer, a snorer on the plane. Ladies, I have a whole new appreciation for what your gentleman put you through. We're trying to fall asleep to the wonderful sounds of... But this gentleman had sleep apnea. This is where in the middle of snoring, you suddenly stop breathing and choke yourself awake. So we would hear... We had a baby on the plane. Do you ever fly with a baby? I didn't mind the... That was all right. The baby right in front of me in the next row, that baby's diaper needed attention. And for some reason, you mommies don't notice this. We're sitting there going, is that your shoes? Is that my shoes? Damn. And she had an attitude. I said, ma'am, for the fourth time, your baby's diaper needs attention. How do I know? There's steam coming out of his ass. He had two seagulls hovering above. We get there, everything's fine. We get on, coming back, we get on, I don't know, 747. It was two seats, five seats. I'm on the two-seat side. Nobody's sitting next to me. I got room to move. It's nice. The captain gets on the loudspeaker. You never understand what the hell they say. It's always, we're sitting there. I'm sitting next to this guy on the aisle from Jamaica. Nice man. Just then, a woman is walking down the aisle towards us. This was a big person. I'm not making fun. I'm a big person myself. But both sides of her tuchus were wedging between both sides of the aisle. I was like... I'm talking about a tush you could see from the front. Talking about somebody, if they were standing outside by themselves, the cops would come over and say, break it up. The Jamaican guy stood up, Lordy Jesus, you see what's coming at us. Please, God, don't let us sit next to me. Please, God, don't.
I believe that's my seat. You don't have to get up.
Lady, I gotta get up because that tuchus ain't getting past this face without doing structural damage.
No, I can get in. I'm in.
No, you're not. Half the behind was still in my seat. I'm sitting on... Can you feel any of this? And she had something called a wedgie. I don't know if you... This is where the pants are all tucked in the middle, in the crease. She had the Grand Canyon of wedgies. I said, excuse me, ma'am. I believe your tuchus is eating your pants. Everybody says, how'd you learn your accents? How'd you do your dialect? I grew up in Brooklyn. Everybody I knew spoke with an accent. It was the way it was. My daddy knew this couple in Brighton Beach. And she used to tell the story about one time she gets up and she goes to the bathroom. A little old lady, she says, comes out, Milton,
what? I got a question. What do you want? You don't see I'm reading? No. I got trouble down there.
Where?
Down there. Where? You know where? In your Virginia? Yeah. Maybe you should go see Dr. Cohn.
So she goes over to Dr. Cohn's office. He examines her. Mrs. Cohn, it's nothing but nothing.
Nothing?
Nothing. You'll be perfectly fine. It's normal. So I can go about your business. It's fine.
Thank you, doctor.
You're welcome. She starts to leave. He says, wait, Mrs. Cohn, are you and your husband still active?
You mean, do we did it?
Yeah.
We still did it.
Well, that's wonderful. Before you do it, you need to take this little medicated pill and put it you know where.
That's it?
That's it. You'll be fine. Well, it's Friday night. There's Sabbath. It's supposed to be a blessing, a mitzvah to do it.
She says, Milty, you wanna did it?
Let's did it.
Goes upstairs to the bedroom. She gets undressed, lies there.
He says, I'm going to go wash up. I'll be. She says, wait. On the count is a pill you should give me first.
He gives her the pill. She puts it you know where. He comes out of the bathroom. He looks down at her little naked body, and her tiny little private part is going like this.
He says, Sophie, what the hell's going on down there?
She said, schmuck, you gave me a chiclet.
I'm Steve Solomon. Bye, everybody. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the very beautiful and talented Miss Lainie Kazan.
Thank you, Sal. Good evening. I am so happy to be here. Hello, everybody. I'm here to celebrate Melissa Manchester, and I'm very pleased to be here for Ed Ames, who's being inducted or adopted into the New York Hall of Fame, the Alumni Club, I guess it is. And I first met Ed many years ago, about 20 years ago, when my late husband was conducting and playing for him when he did his show, his nightclub act. And he came to hear me sing the last time I was at the Catalina Jazz Club. And he requested this song, and so I want to share it with him, sing it for him, and tell him I love him. Oi! No complaints and no regrets. I still believe in chasing dreams and placing bets. And I believe that all you give is all you get. So give it all you've got. I've had my share and drank my fill, and even though I'm satisfied, I'm hungry still to see what's down another road beyond the hill and do it all again. So here's to life and every joy it brings. Here's to life, to dreamers and their dreams. How love can go from warm hellos to sad goodbyes, then leave you with the memories you've memorized to keep your love anew. For there's no yes in yesterday, and who knows what tomorrow brings. gives or takes away. As long as I'm still in this game, I'm gonna play for laughs, for life, for love. So here's to life and every joy it brings. Here's to life, to dreamers and their dreams. May I stop the weather and all that's good get better. Here's to life, here's to love, and here's to you. Shelley Markham at the piano.
Then we get the kids together, we gotta do that poem, "'Twas the Night Before Christmas," and all through the house. "'Twas the Night." I'm Italian, I'm from Brooklyn. I never heard anybody in my neighborhood ever use the word "'twas." It is not in our vocabulary. Can you hear a guy from Benson Hills going, "'Hey, Teresa, 'twas your brother home?" And we gotta do that poem. Now, I have my cousin Anthony, he's 16 years old, he's in the second grade. And he had to do, what happened? He had to do this poem, "'Twas the Night Before Christmas," and they asked him to take it home and study it. This poor kid studied all night, put the paper in his pocket, went to the assembly program the next morning, and this is how he conceived that poem in his mind. All right, I'm gonna do that poem about the night that nobody even knew was there. I was sitting around a house, I didn't hear nothing. It was very, 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 very quiet. All of a sudden, I hear noise on the roof. Ooh, in my neighborhood, that's trouble. You guys are great. You want to sit in here and fill in the gaps? I look out the window, there's a fat guy with a red suit on my roof. Who the hell is this guy on my friggin' roof? In the middle of the friggin' night. He had a bunch of aminals on the roof with hangers on their heads. Now this fat guy starts to climb down my chimney. The animals start to shit all over my roof. I go next door to my neighbor, Sal. He says, "It's your holiday. What are you bothering me for? You'll clean it up." So I was in Atlantic City one afternoon. It was a beautiful, balmy day, just a soft breeze coming off the ocean. And I took a stroll on the boardwalk, and I heard two guys digesting. And I was behind them. "Hey, Murray, let's go down here, okay?" What the hell was that? Why don't we go this way? "You see any boats out there?" "No, but I smell a ship coming in."
The Ed Sullivan Show.
And here are the famous singing stars, the Ames Brothers.
Take me along.
If you love me,
take me along with you.
Along, along, along.
Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. You may have recognized that song as being one of the hits from the great smash Broadway show Take Me Along, which stars Jackie Gleason. Jackie is here tonight, and it's our pleasure to have you meet him. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Jackie Gleason.
Now, here are my pals, the Ames
Richards Brothers. Let's go!
Thank you very much. Thank you, Jackie. Right now, ladies and gentlemen, we'd like to have a little fun with you. We'd like to show you how, as they sing their big hit records in person.
Now, he's a great guy, a great singer, and a great personality. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. King Farouk. King Cole.
They try to tell us we're too young.
It sounds like King Levinsky. What happened here?
Too young to rally they in love. And then someday they may recall.
About the best defense lawyer a lot of money can buy. Spence Cogan from Dallas, Texas.
Well, 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 Jason McCabe. Long time no see, partner. How you been?
Don't tell me you came all the way over here to defend Travis Forrester.
Well, I go where the money is. You know that, Jason. Say, why don't you cross on over to my side? Defense, that's where the money is.
Well, I guess I'm old-fashioned or something, but I still prefer defending the victim.
Well, you always was a good old soul, Jason. I bet you still say your prayers, don't you?
Sometimes.
Well.
I used to remember the fire of September that made us mellow. Deep in December, our hearts should remember. And
Daniel, when an Indian moves up in a camp that quietly, it usually means only one thing.
Okay, Mingo.
Well, shall we have
a go? Get your axe and let's go.
All right,
What is the trick on this? You throw underhanded?
No.
Oh, the, overhanded.
It's an overhand throw. The trick is to keep your arm extended, and that way you break the microphone. You know, you keep your arm extended and put only one revolution on the...
Once around
on the way. But that's indefinite.
All right.
To bring out two wonderful people right now. This young lady, not only is she a great singer, a great actress, a wonderful performer, and just an all-around great lady. She just did her first directorial job. She directed a movie that she wrote the screenplay to. It's called Saving Grace, B. Jones, the multi-talented and very beautiful Miss Connie Stevens. And also, for the 50th decade, this show is back on the air, hosted by Wayne Brady, the creator, the wonderful guy that held it all together for so many years. Let's make a deal. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Monte Hall.
Well, I think I'm first up. I can't tell you how happy I am. My old tennis buddy, my pal. So fun to be here for you, Ed. We have a very special surprise for you. One of your favorite people, and certainly one of mine and all of yours. He's here. He was adopted last year. Jack Klugman wants to say a few words for you.
I don't know how many of you had the privilege of hearing Ed Ames sing My Foolish Heart. It is beautiful. It is gorgeous. And he is beautiful. I met him with Bernie Capel and Lynn and Katrina. And I just fell in love with him. He's a wonderful man. He's beautiful inside. He's gorgeous, and I don't know what to say, except I love you. I think you're terrific, and you're a great singer.
Yes. Yeah.
I think you really know what to say, Jack.
So, Monty, I think you have to do your duty. Do you have your sword?
Ed, it's my privilege every year.
Here.
Here you go.
My privilege every year to induct an honorary New Yorker.
You want to give me a better one?
Sure.
Good. And you will repeat what I'm going to say to you because this is a formal induction. Okay. You repeat after me. Is that right?
Yes.
You know, it's interesting that I was reading in the program that Ed is the youngest of nine children, but the Ames brothers were the last four of the nine. And what a great show to put on. The Ames brothers and the great baritone Ed Ames became a great actor, singer, wonderful baritone, and a moil. So will you repeat after me? I hereby acknowledge and recognize.
I hereby acknowledge and recognize.
The outstanding history and vitality.
The outstanding history and vitality.
Of the people of New York.
Of the people of New York.
I recall my wonderful memories of having lived and worked in New York.
I recall my wonderful memories of having lived and worked in New York.
And I promise to wear proudly the mantle.
And I promise to wear proudly the mantle.
As a son of the great city of New York.
The son of the great city of New York.
And if the Yankees play Boston in a playoff, nah.
I hope Boston wins.
That concludes my share of the program.
No, I think I'm going to have to change my allegiance. I'm originally from Boston, Massachusetts.
I know about that. So if Boston plays New York, leave the room.
Well, okay. I won't cheer for either one.
You don't have to worry about it. The Angels are looking after Boston.
That's true. After 150 years.
So now, with the powers that invested me by the Mayor Bloomberg of New York, I will adopt you as a loving son of the city of New York, and I will get my stick over here to... knight you. See, what we do is, you can't kneel, you're pretty tall, but I'll knight you. See, I'll go like this and like that, and then that becomes official and you become the... Wait, this is not the right thing. Would you get me something more official, please?
Oh, my God.
Now, you know, with this ceremony... there's a certain thing we have to do, but I won't do it. I won't do it.
Never point a gun or a tomahawk, please.
I'm going to officially knight you as an honorary citizen of New York City. Ed Ames, congratulations. It's a pleasure to induct you.
Thank you very
much. Thank you.
We have one more surprise for you. From Boston, law school? It's not law school, it's public school, that you went to. You remember that?
1902, you remember. It was a wonderful year.
This happens to be one of the oldest public schools in America, by the way. And
he's, Ed was the first, he was the first student when it opened in 1635.
1635.
He is here tonight, Malcolm Flynn. Come on out. Here he is.
From the Boston Public School.
From the Boston Public School.
I believe there's a video to show first.
This video goes with this?
I guess so.
I think there is.
The video looks like all of them.
It has been promised.
Some Latin school is the oldest high school in the history of America, founded in 1635. And I was the first graduate.
These are graduates.
Will you please?
Boston Latin School was founded in 1635. We're the nation's oldest school, and we predate Harvard by 1 year. Latin school students value achievement. There is a sense here at the school that if you do well, you will be successful. We talk a lot about tradition and how in joining us, young people are a part of a lifelong legacy.
Earliest infancy, it was here to provide, you know, academics, or actually trained students, so they could then go on to study, become ministers, and then subsequently to provide, you know, an education for the more, you know, upper, the elite merchant class of Boston itself in the early years of the colony. And then as that evolved after independence, you know, it was founded in the tradition of a public, you know, grammar school from England, and they kept to study all the way through the 19th century.
And I am here today representing the now headmaster, Lynn Mooney Tater, in honoring Ed Ames as you honor him by adopting him as a New Yorker. And I was very happy to hear that he did not disavow the Boston Red Sox a moment ago, even though they are in deep trouble right now.
True.
Boston Latin School, as you have seen, is the oldest school in America. And it has changed a little bit since Ed Ames was a student there. In 1944, when he graduated, it was an all-boys school. And it was, as Nat Hentoff and Theodore White, two graduates of the same era, wrote in a couple of autobiographies, a cruel school. Theodore White said it was a cruel school. It took in all comers, regardless of race, creed, color, political affiliation. But it also flunked out, regardless of race, creed, color, or political affiliation. And Ed Ames is one of the one-third of students who entered who graduated. That's a great accomplishment in itself. And during his time, he studied 5 years of Latin, the kids still do, 4 years of French, kids still do study 4 years of modern language. I think he studied 2 years of German. I'm not sure why he didn't take Greek.
No, he didn't.
It was a very difficult school, and Ed survived it. He did a very excellent job. And I have here for him today a couple of things. The first will not open. This contains Ed's school record. That is for his pleasure. He may look at it when he gets home or throw it in the fireplace. I'm not sure.
That's great.
The second is a special award for exemplary conduct and fidelity to Edmund Dante Urich, for exemplary conduct and fidelity. This prize is awarded to one pupil in each division, selected by their masters as conspicuous for faithful endeavor, regardless of mere rank in class, given this 10th day of October 2009.
Thank you very much.
The Fidelity Prize recognizes that getting good grades is not the only important thing in school. The second of these awards is for top scholars, and Ed Ames is receiving this for all of the great things that he has done since graduating from Boston Latin School, including some three decades later, going to college and getting his bachelor's and master's degrees from UCLA. Even in Boston, we recognize UCLA as a pretty good school. Edmund Dante Yurick was this day reported to receive a public expression of approbation with distinction for industry and good conduct during a lifetime of entertaining the public, given this 10th day of October 2009. Congratulations.
So before it was Ames, it was Yurick.
That's correct.
Alas, poor Yurick, I knew him well, Horatio.
That's what my teachers used to say all the time.
Right? I was your teacher.
Right. You graduated even before me.
I graduated before there was graduation. Listen.
Hey, guys, let me do the jokes, all right, please?
Congratulations, Ed. Thank Welcome you. To the family.
Thank you so much, Mom.
And I'd just like to say one thing as a part of this, because I've always admired you my whole life. On this weekend, which is Columbus Day weekend, buona salute.
Molte grazie.
E tutta famiglia.
Grazie a lei.
Prego.
Latin was not the only language I learned.
I know. We spoke about it in the back.
Ah.
Does that conclude our ceremony?
All right. What's next? That's it?
Where are you?
Well,
that concludes our ceremony. So let us give a nice hand to our new inductee, Ed Ames.
Ed Ames, ladies and gentlemen. Monte Hall. Thank Connie Stevens. Now, Mr. Ames is going to, I believe, he's going to sing.
Ed.
Yes.
Ed. Good. Which one do you want to use?
I think I'll use this. Well, what an evening. Thank you very much, all of you. And thank you all for coming tonight. It's such a wonderful evening for me, because it gives me a chance to see all my friends in show business and even out of show business, and to be able to welcome the wonderful Jack and Connie and just about everybody that came tonight, all the beautiful people, my wife, Jeannie, who's sitting out there, about the fourth row back there. Jeannie, would you stand up? And she's out there sweating and quelling at the same time, as all good wives do. Well, I would like to sing a couple songs. If you think it's easy to stand out here and have a lot of people lie about you and feign humility, it ain't easy to do, I'll tell you. No, but I do feel very honored, and I feel humiliated. But I would like to sing, and I guess we can just do it. I'd like you to meet my musical director, Andy. Andy Howe. Some of my good friends in the orchestra. So we are going to try to do a couple songs for you, Andy.
Here we go. One, two, two. And
away out here, they got a name. Rain and wind and fire. The rain is Tess, the fire is Joe, and they call the wind Mariah. Mariah blows the stars around, sends the clouds a-flying. Mariah makes the mountain sound like focuses up there dying. Mariah. sun was always shining. Then one day I left my gal, I left her far behind me, and now I'm lost, so cold and lost, not even God can find me. Mariah, Mariah, they call the wind Mariah. Out here they got a name for wind and fire only. But when you're lost and all alone, there ain't no word but lonely. And I'm a lost and lonely man, without a star to guide me. Mariah, blow my love to me, I need my gal beside me. Mariah, Mariah, they call the wind Mariah. I had a special request tonight from John Alexander, our director, who does a wonderful job. May we have a little round of applause for John? He's back there. He does it all. He does those videos. He does the lights, everything. And he asked me to sing his favorite song. And I'm not sure because, you know, we have a rather long show tonight. And I'm not sure that I'll be able to sing this song for John because of the shortage of time. So, John, I have to... I better sing it. This is a wonderful song. This is my first big hit record. Sometimes in the morning when shadows are deep, I lie here beside you just watching you sleep. Sometimes I whisper what I'm thinking of, my cup runneth over with love. Sometimes in the evening when you do not see, I study the small things you do constantly. I memorize moments that I'm fondest of, my cup runneth over with love. In only a moment we both will be old. Moment with sunlight above, my cup runneth over with love. My cup runneth over with love. Years ago, we put together a show to take to Broadway. We never made it, but we went to Branson, Missouri to break the show in. The show was called The Great American Songbook, and in it were all the wonderful songs all the way back from minstrel days. George M. Cohan, Irving Berlin, George Gershwin, Rodgers and Hammerstein, wonderful, wonderful songs. But the one song that people seemed to ask me to repeat was a song that I'm going to sing for you now. It's from Showboat. It's an oldie, but a goodie. And so, for them and for you, I would like to sing the song from Showboat. Here we all work on the Mississippi. Here we all work while the white folk play. Towing them boats from the wrong till sunset. Getting no rest till the judgment day. Don't look up, don't look down. And don't ask, make the white boss frown. Bend your knees and bow your head. Pull that rope until you're dead. Let me go away from the Mississippi. Let me go away from the white man boss. Show me that stream called the River Jordan. There's the old stream that I long to cross. Oh, man river, that old man river, he must know something, but it don't say nothing. He just keeps rolling. Keeps on rolling along. He don't plant taters, he don't plant cotton, and them that plant 'em be soon forgotten. But old man river, it just along. You and me, we sweat and strain, body all aching and racked with pain. Tote that barge, lift that bale. You get a little drunk and you land in jail. I'm tired of living, but I'm scared of dying. But old man river, he just keeps rolling along.
God bless Ed Ames. My goodness. My God. What an honor. What a pleasure.